Good morning, subscriber. It's Saturday, 1 a.m. in the morning here in Sydney, March 18, 2017. Before I start, I would like to acknowledge Benoit Mandelbrot for bringing to us the concept of fractals, for letting us see the obvious that in the real world outside, you don't see Euclidean perfect triangles, perfect circles, squares, all these things that are perfect triangles, squares, and circles are all man-made. Nature is full of fractals. These are self-similar things that look the same no matter how deep you go into them, go into the scale. So they're self-similar. And he was able to show it by using computers that use recursion. It's like the Ouroboros or the head, the snake eating its tail. That's through recursion of formulas. He was able to show us that the universe, our nature, is really full of fractals. And maybe the way to understand the secrets of the universe is through fractal geometry. So, très bien, Benoit Mandelbrot. So I just came back from watching an Australian play at the Sydney Opera House. It's called Away, and apparently it's an Australian classic. It's been playing since the 1980s, and I do believe it's a classic. I believe it's a play of such a good quality that it will last for a long time. It's a joint production by the Sydney Theatre Company, STC, and Malt House from Melbourne. Since I'm low in funds at the moment, in terms of money, I was invited by my friend, who was one of the main actresses in the play. So I got to watch in this box behind the theatre, and I got to stay in the green room before the play. And I got to hang out in the dressing room after the play. It was an amazing experience. So the play, what I like about the play itself, Away, is that it works on so many levels. So it tackles themes such as war, relationships between couples, like husband and wife, relationships between parents and children, adolescence, coming of age, death, what it means to be Australian in the 60s, and what was happening there with the war in Vietnam and all this influx of immigration of new migrants into Australia at that time. And so rich in the way it delved into universal human issues. It's so amazing. I mean, I love streaming television. Like, I like Game of Thrones, I like Billions, I like Taboo, I like Battlestar Galactica. I love all this shit, but I also love, there's nothing that could substitute for live theater. There's just something in the Clairvision School of Meditation I go to. There's something about the ethericity. It's this thing called the etheric, which is a layer of one of our subtle bodies that passes between the actors and the people that are present on the audience and actors on stage. There's something that passes that you cannot, that it's not the same if it's mediated by bits. There's something about being there that is qualitatively different. I mean, I'm not saying one is better than the other, but it's just different. Yeah, so it's amazing to watch. I haven't seen a play for a while because I've been a student and I haven't been earning that much money to really afford them. Unfortunately, they're not as affordable as one would think. But anyway, I'm hoping to change that. I'm working on my finances. That's my next, at least my current project is to put more attention on my finances. So going back, so I saw the play. I was in this box right behind the sound booth. It's amazing. I was in my own box and I could watch people and watch the play and stand up and all that. And then I got to hang out with the actors in their dressing room, and it's just so good to see how it must be a fascinating lifestyle to be an actor, you know, like you get to play roles and you get to step into character and step out of it. And it's just, as my friend was saying, such a fun occupation. It's like you never grew up, it's just you're a kid all the time because you're always playing, you know, that's amazing. It's just amazing. Which brings me to the subject of flexibility, you know. Sometimes there's a weird tendency to think that, oh, I'm enlightened, so I should always be zen. You know, I'm just zen, nothing will touch me. But it's not quite that. Sometimes when life faces you the right, not the right, but the natural, or that what I feel is the right reaction is to get angry. That's cool, it's good to get angry. Sometimes it's good to be a victim. Oh, I'm so helpless. Or sometimes it's good to be a predator. Oh, I want to chase that thing. That's cool. If it comes out organically in your body, in my body, in my consciousness. When it gets, when it's not really good, is when it has run its course, but I hold on to it. That's what we call resentment. Literally, a resentment is you're resenting the same stimulus over and over again. It's like, when I was in my fucking grade school, you didn't say hi to me, and you're like 40 years old, and you're still... That story is still playing in my mind. That's when it's not healthy, you know? This is resenting of something that's already gone. There's this beautiful short story by a Filipino writer who writes in English, and it's called, I think it's Dead Stars, and it's about a love, you know, a coming of age love story, and he fell in love with this woman, and years later he's still thinking about her, and finally he met her, and he saw that all those years, what I was seeing was the light of dead stars, because yeah, like the light we're seeing in the stars now, they were shining years ago. The nearest star I think is 4 light years away, or maybe 2 or 4, whatever. But it means that the light we're seeing now came from that star 4 years ago. So for all we know, that thing could be dead and we wouldn't know until 4 years later. That's how large, maybe it's a phenomenon of large distances. It's good to be flexible, not to, and it's fun as well. Like, it's good to be angry and let it out, but then don't let it pester, you know. It's good to be fluid and to, like my friend Nicole Maydarn says, it's to be in pitch perfect resonance to life as it is, not how we want it to be or how we want to control it, but how we want it, how it is. It's just being resonance and always finding the good in what's happening, instead of, oh, it's not going my way, it's fucked. No, it's always a way to respond in a healthy way, you know. Like I remember when I was back in the Philippines during my first bachelor degree, my undergraduate at the Ateneo de Manila, we had this subject called Man's Search for Meaning. I think it's now called Human Quest for Meaning, because in this day nowadays you need to be more gender aware of the terms we use. But anyway, one of the readings in that course was this book by Viktor Frankl, which is Man's Search for Meaning, where he talked about his experiences being concentration camps during the Holocaust. And he would observe people. Some people just lost it, just gave up, some went crazy. But there was a few people, including him, who survived. Even in the worst conditions possible. They survived, and the reason they survived is they found meaning. Like my friend Marcus Newton was a guest, my first guest in Complex Human, said we were having this continuous discussion about happiness and meaning. So really what it comes to, it's the goal of life is not really to be happy, because really happy is arguably is just an emotion. It's a feeling that comes and goes, but the real joy comes from having a meaning, because with meaning you can be suffering and it still has meaning, and you will go through the suffering because it has meaning. Whereas with happiness, what if you're no longer feeling happy at that moment? You just give up on what you were doing. You just give up the quest. So it's just, you know, like, as I say, I'm more about the questions than the answers. I'm not here in this confessions. I'm not proposing. I don't pretend to have any answer. What I have for you are questions, and we can talk about it. And I'm happy to discuss. I think it's good to discuss things, and I love seeing different points of view. And I just go, that makes sense, but I don't agree with that. I agree with that. I think it's a healthier way of living, and it's like this concept of cosmopolitan. It's a cosmopolitan intermingling of ideas. Which brings me to this interesting, I've been watching a lot of Slavoj Zizek videos, and he has some good points. He was saying that this, in a way, empathy or understanding someone different from us, it's gone crazy, it's gone overboard, because we can't really understand other people who are so different from us. And we could pretend that Australians, white Australians, people who came here from Europe, can pretend to understand Aboriginal people. But I don't think we can, because they're unique. They have their own way of life, and at the same time we shouldn't force them to understand us, because they can't. The same way we can't. It's a weird thing that some of the left people from the left pretend they know what it is to be an Aboriginal people, and I don't know, it's a bit presumptuous. And some people, there's a big thing now about some people just appropriating cultural things from the Aboriginal culture and just pretending they understand it, in the same way that some people just take something like ayahuasca and think they understand the whole tradition behind taking this plant. You know, it's not just about the plant. You know, sometimes we confuse the symbol or the sign for the signified. It's like saying that, oh, most successful investment bankers wear a coat and a tie. So the real secret to becoming a successful businessman or a successful investment banker is wearing a nice suit. Well, not really. You can wear the best looking suit in the world, but if you don't have the understanding and you don't have the knowing or the news, you don't have the knowing of what you're doing, it won't matter. You're confusing the outward appearances with what is really essential. There's a big problem now in the world. It's and it becomes even worse with big data. there's a deep confusion between correlation and causation, you know. Just because you can get the data and see, oh, this variable is correlated to that, it doesn't mean this is causing that. I'm sure, given enough computing power in the world, you can relate the firing of a gun in Shanghai with the price of nectarines in Chicago. But it doesn't mean that the firing of the gun caused the rise in the price of nectarines in Chicago. But you can if you crunch enough samples, statistical samples, and you just go through them and try to find what you want, I'm sure you can find something. So it's sad that like some newspapers will publish some of these things and people will just believe them, and 2 years later they will retract it. And, you know, like drinking wine. 1 year you'll see an article saying it's good for you, another year it's bad for you. It's just an interesting phenomenon that we can't rely on experts anymore, because I think even experts don't know what's going on. But at the same time, in order to understand what's going on, you have to invest a lot of time in getting the groundwork, you know, in really understanding, in really learning. I guess the biggest competitive, if you're a competitive person, or if you just want to thrive in the future, the biggest thing, in my opinion, that people should learn is we should learn how to learn faster. Because things are accelerating so quickly. And if you don't keep up, it's just like in Alice in Wonderland, it's just like the Red Queen, and Alice goes, well, where I came from, if you run fast enough, then you'll be ahead of people. And then the Red King, well, here, the Red King says, here, you just have to keep, you have to run fast just to keep where you are. And in order to get ahead, you have to even run faster. I think we're entering that time. And we really have to be smart on how we do it. So I'm gonna slowly close this episode up, and I'm gonna close it by mentioning I'm currently reading this book, Thrive, by Arianna Huffington. And it's interesting, she's saying that instead of, you know, you're given this model, this paradigm that in order to succeed in the world you need wealth and power, and that's, you should give up everything to get that. And then she realized in her story in the book, she had health problems with just trying to stay ahead, trying to run this treadmill of success, that hang on, maybe just maybe it's not about playing the game, it's redefining the game. And she redefines this in several ways. And right now I'm in the chapter, the first part, the first redefining of the paradigm, where she talks about well-being. So in a way, which actually makes sense, but sometimes you have to point out the obvious and be hit by it to really wake up. It's like it's no use being the CEO of a large company, fulfilling your dreams, and then you're sick and you die of cancer. It just doesn't make sense. So sometimes we need to take care, or not sometimes, we do need to take care of ourselves, because without our health, we can't do anything. So I'm just going through that, and she talks about meditation. I'm a meditator, so that's, I'm on board with that. I can vouch from my own personal experience that meditation has done me a lot of good. So with that, I'm going to end this episode. Again, I'm really grateful for you listening, and I hope you get something out of listening and watching these episodes. And if you happen to encounter this video by accident, please subscribe by clicking the button, subscribe button in my YouTube channel, so you'll be informed when new episodes come in, and also helps me make this channel better. The more subscriber, the better the channel becomes, and I'll be grateful if you do that. And also share with your friends and comment if you have comments. And I'm gonna say goodbye now, and I just wanna say, I love you. I love humans. I love being in this earth. And it's so good to be here.